different phases of the journey, different seasons of the journey. But every phase and every season, God wants us to walk by faith and to live by faith. And faith comes by hearing, but how many of you know it works by doing? It's not enough just to hear the word. You've got to put the word into practice. And here at Victory Assembly of God, as a pastor, I try my best by the grace of God to promote to you the importance of the word of God. Especially when you hear of research and polls that have been done that say Providence, Rhode Island is the least biblically literate city in America. I don't know about you, but that should get your blood, your spiritual blood boiling a little bit and say, God, God help us. God, we need to change that. And it needs to start right here. You know, right here, right now with you and I, that we are intentional and committed to the word of God. There's no other standard, there's no other philosophy, there's no other authority except the Bible, the Word of God. And so I try to make sure that when we do come to church, whether it's a Sunday and Wednesday, just on Wednesday night, we're going to go through the seven churches of the book of Revelation. And it's interesting, it's the only portion of Scripture where Jesus directly speaks to the existing church. He spoke to it prophetically in the Gospels, but he speaks to it directly and specifically. And we're going to go through each of the seven churches over the next several Wednesday nights. But we do want to make sure that anytime a preacher, a teacher steps into the pulpit, that they read the Word of God and speak the Word of God. And you might say, well, that's not too profound or too deep, but you'd be surprised how even the Bible prophesies that in the last days there will be a famine, not of bread, not of physical food, but there'll be a famine of the Word of God. It won't be preached everywhere, won't be read, it won't be acknowledged. But we want to do that this morning. Amen. I say all that to say we're going to read several verses of Scripture, so open up your Bibles. And we want to look at a man called Caleb this morning. Caleb, he had a different spirit. He had a different spirit. I don't know about you, but that should be your heart and your desire to have a different spirit. Not just to be different. You know, some people want to be different, so they'll dress a certain way. They'll get inked up all over. They'll spike their hair. They'll wear funny-looking clothes or whatever because they want to stand out and they want to be different. But I'm not talking about that kind of difference. I'm talking about having a different spirit. I'm talking about standing up for God and standing out for God and being different. And all the more in the day and age that we do live in, the people of God need to stand out and stand up and be heard. It's amazing how in our culture, everybody is speaking out. Everybody has an opinion. Everybody has a cause. And some of them might be good. Some of them might be worthwhile. But people are not afraid to speak up and to stand up and be heard. And how much more when we, as the children of God, have the word of God and have the words of eternal life, should we not be speaking up? Should we not be heard? Amen? Well, let's look at a man called Caleb. Let's go to Joshua first. Joshua chapter 14 and several verses of scripture starting in verse 4. Then the children of Judah came to Joshua in Gilgal, and Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, the Kenizzite, said to him, "You know the word which the Lord said to Moses, the man of God, concerning you and me in Kadesh Barnea. I was 40 years old when Moses, the servant of the Lord, sent me from Kadesh Barnea to spy out the land." Kadesh Barnea was very close to the promised land. It was a short distance, a short journey from the promised land. And it should have been the point of entry, or it should have been at least the proximity of where the children of Israel would go in and possess the land. They were to go to possess the land which was promised to Abraham 700, 800 years previous. And that was so critical and so much a part of the covenant that God promised to Abraham to give them the land of Canaan. But as you know, the children of Israel did not believe God. And instead of a short journey of just a few days, they ended up on a journey of 40 years. How many of you know that if we don't obey the Lord and we don't trust God, we might get where we need to go, but it might take us a whole lot longer. And I don't want to go the long route. I don't want to go through the wilderness. I want to go the Lord's direct route. Amen? And so the Bible tells us, he said, I was 40 years old, and I brought back word to him as it was in my heart. Nevertheless, my brethren who went up with me made the heart of the people melt. But I wholly follow the Lord my God. So Moses swore on that day, saying, surely the land where your foot is trodden shall be your inheritance and your children's forever, because you wholly follow the Lord your God. And now behold, the Lord has kept me alive. The Lord has kept me alive. How many of you know your exercise, although it's good, your eating properly is important, doesn't keep you alive, but the Lord keeps you alive. It's not your gym membership. It's not your barley green vegetables or your juicing. Although those are good and healthy and important, I don't want to downplay that. I think we should be eating better and exercising, because we are the temple of the Lord. But how many of you know that doesn't keep you alive? It's the Lord that keeps you alive. And Caleb said, he said, the Lord has kept me alive. Come on, you ought to say thank God, because truly we need God and his grace, and we need to trust him and be dependent upon him, because it's the Lord that keeps us alive. And he said, these 45 years, those are the 40 so years of wandering, and then the 5 years of the children of Israel going in to possess the land. Up until this point, Caleb had not received his inheritance, and his people had not inherited their portion yet. Ever since the Lord spoke this word to Moses while Israel wandered in the wilderness, and now here I am this day, 85 years old. Now, some of you might get a little confused and say, well, back in the Old Testament, they lived to 800 and 900 years old, and they did before the flood. Then after the flood, the age is diminished, and the average age of a man at that point would have been 100 or 120 years old. I was talking to my wife the other day. I said, what was it like to live to, you know, 800? Yeah. Oh, I'm celebrating my 700th birthday. How old are you? I'm 750 years old. Wouldn't that be cool, though? The oldest man in the Bible, if you're playing Bible trivia, Methuselah. He was 969 years old, recorded. I don't know if anybody lived longer than that, but in the Bible, the oldest man recorded age, 969 years old. I'm sure they look pretty good. I mean, look at Abraham's wife at 100 years old. The king of the Pharaoh looked at her and wanted to take her as his wife. She must have looked pretty good for 100 years old. But think of living 600, 700, 800 years. Well, anyway, in this passage of Scripture, they lived to 100 maybe, 110. But here he is, 85 years old. So he's at the end of his journey. But I love what he said. Look what he said. But as my strength was then, so is my strength, so now is my strength for war, both for going out and for coming in. Now, therefore, give me this mountain of which the Lord spoke in that day. For you heard in that day how the Anakim were there, and that the cities were great and fortified. It may be that the Lord will be with me, and I shall be able to drive them out, as the Lord said. And Joshua blessed him and gave Hebron to Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, as an inheritance. Hebron therefore became the inheritance of Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, the Kenizzite, to this day, because he wholly followed the Lord God of Israel. We look at this passage of Scripture, and I want to just talk to you for a few moments about having a different spirit. Having a different spirit. In the book of Numbers, if you would turn with me to Numbers chapter 13, we're going to go back these 40 odd years, and we're going to look at why the children of Israel did not go into the promised land when they should have, but ended up wandering for 40 years. In Numbers chapter 13, we see in verses 1 and 2, it says, the Lord spoke to Moses saying, send men to spy out the land of Canaan, which I am giving to the children of Israel. From each tribe of their fathers you shall send a man, everyone a leader among them. So Moses sent them from the wilderness of Paran according to the command of the Lord. Listen, all of them, men who were heads of the children of Israel. They were, the Bible says, everyone a leader among them. And it also said they were heads of their people. They were leaders. So you have to understand something, that having a different spirit doesn't require you to have a title. Having a different spirit doesn't require you to be a leader, so to speak. But you will be a leader if you have a different spirit. But the Bible shows us here that there were 12 spies that were sent out to bring back a report of the land. The Bible tells us that 10 of the leaders brought back an evil report. They brought back a report of unbelief. Now, they were all believers in Jehovah. They were all believers in God. But they did not have faith to believe that God could do what he promised to do. I believe that even in the church, there are a lot of believers in God, but not necessarily believers in his word. Come on now, hear me this morning, because this is very relevant, because you have a mountain in your life. You have a challenge. You have land and spiritual inheritances that you need to possess, but it's not going to be a cakewalk. You have to have a different spirit. You have to be a person of faith to inherit the promises that God has for you. I'm talking about spiritual promises. I'm talking about a spiritual inheritance. So the 10 bring back an evil report, but there are two. There's only two. Think about that. 2 out of 12. That's a small percentage. What would that be? 17%? Think about that. A small percentage brought back a good report, and that was Joshua and Caleb. And in Numbers chapter 14, if you would turn over to the next page, it says, in Numbers chapter 14, verse 24, but my servant Caleb, there he is again, because he has a different spirit in him and has wholly followed me, or has followed me fully, I will bring into the land where he went, and his descendants shall inherit it. Now, I want to take just a few moments as we look at this and contrast the 10 spies with Joshua or with Caleb. I want to contrast them. Look at chapter 13, verse 28. Here is the report of the 10 spies. Verse 27, it says, we went into the land where you sent us. It truly flows with milk and honey, and this is its fruit. Nevertheless, yes, but nevertheless, you could almost hear it in their voice. Nevertheless, the people who dwell in the land are strong. Their cities are fortified and very large. Moreover, we saw the descendants of Anak there. Those are giants. So contrast that. Now, what are they focusing on? They're focusing on the wrong things. They're focusing on the obstacles, the strength of the people, the fortification of the cities, the size of the giants. Now look at what Joshua and Caleb say. Go back or look at verse 30. Then Caleb quieted the people before Moses and said, let us go up at once and take possession, for we are well able to overcome it. You see the spirit of this man starting to come forth. See how different it was. Now look at, again, we're contrasting. Look at verse 31. It says, but the men who had gone up with them, the 10 spies, said, we are not able to go up against the people, for they are stronger than we. What did Caleb say? He says, we are well able. We're able to overcome them. Look at verse 32. Again, we're contrasting. They bring back a bad report, and they gave the children of Israel a bad report of the land which they had spied out, saying, the land, look at this, through which we have gone as spies is a land that devours its inhabitants. What does that mean? It eats up its inhabitants. It'll eat us up. But now look at the contrast. Look at chapter 14 of verse 8. Do not rebel against the Lord. This is Caleb speaking. To do not rebel against the Lord, nor fear the people, for they are our bread. What does that mean? We could eat them up. Look at what the 10 spies said. They said, they will eat us up. Caleb said, we'll eat them up. What a difference. What a totally radical outlook and perspective of faith that they had, that Caleb had. He had a different spirit. They saw the same things. See, the problem was that the 10 spies were measuring God by their giants. But Caleb was measuring the giants by their God. And it was totally different. And you and I, as people of God, have to understand that you will face overwhelming difficulties and challenges and mountains. We sang this morning, it was sang by Patricia, you know, if faith can move the mountains, God knew. God knows there's mountains in your way. And the attitude and the different spirit is to say, we are able. God is able to make a way. God is able to make a way. God can do it. Not, we are not able. God cannot do it. You know, and the reality of it is, both of them were right. Because according to your faith, so be it unto you. But what did Caleb say? The Lord is with us. The 10 spies said, it's too much. It's too big. It's too difficult. There are giants in the land. You could probably look in your own life. And you could probably rehearse the impossible situations in your life. If you were to get a chart of paper and you would draw a line through the center of that paper, halfway down on the paper, you would draw a line and that would be your life for maybe a 20-year period. And every challenge, every loss, every setback, every struggle would be indicated by the line going downward, meaning it's just below the surface and it's deep and it's a setback and it's a low point in your life. And at that point, if you look back at those times, you would have thought, I don't know how I'm going to get through this. I don't know how I'm going to be able to face tomorrow. I don't know how I'm going to be able to breathe again. But when you look at that chart, you'll see that somehow, some way, you came back up. Somehow, some way, you came and you broke that line and you once again went above and you once again had a breakthrough and you once again experienced the blessing of God. That's why it's so important to look back and see where the Lord has brought you from. The psalmist said, if it had not been the Lord who was on our side, when men rose up against us, they would have destroyed us. But the Lord was on our side. I don't know about you, but I've lived this many times. I remember in both of our building projects, both Admiral Street and this building, I had a pastor, and I believe he meant well, but I think he was one of the 10 spies. He meant well, but in both instances, he said to me, it's going to be too much for you. It's going to cost. There's too much renovation. There's too much cost. It's going to be too much. It's going to be too difficult. You know what? He was right. It was too much for me. But it wasn't too much for God. Did it stretch me to the limits? Did it go beyond my capacity? Yes, but that's what faith does. And if you are living a life where you have it all under control, it's not taking much faith. But when you're living and you're beyond and you're living your life that to the point where unless God shows up, you're going to fail. Unless God shows up, you're not going to make it through. And when we begin to depend upon our own ability and our own strength, then we're not at a good place. How to have a different spirit. Now, I want to just look at this for a few moments. See, Caleb, he stood apart spiritually. Caleb was a person of faith. Caleb went against the tide of compromise and complacency. Brothers and sisters, as a pastor, part of my responsibility is to put the trumpet to my mouth like the prophet Amos was instructed to do and to blow a trumpet in the land. In these times where I as a pastor have to blow the trumpet and sound the alarm and let the people of God know that we have to fight against complacency and compromise. I was reading the book of Ezekiel not too long ago, and in chapters 3 and I believe in chapter 30 or 33, the Lord instructed Ezekiel and said, listen, I want you to go to the people and I want you to warn them of their sin. I want you to warn the wicked. And he said, as a watchman, that's your responsibility. As a watchman, you need to get up at that vantage point, at that high point, and see if an enemy's coming. You need to blow the trumpet and warn the people. And he said, you need to warn the people if they're in sin, if they're living compromising and complacent lives, you need to warn them. And if you warn them and they repent, praise God. If they don't, then their blood is on their head. But he warned the prophet. He said, if you don't warn them, if you don't challenge them, if you don't preach the word to them, and he says, if you don't do that, he says, their blood is going to be on your head. What a responsibility for a pastor, for a preacher. But brothers and sisters, that's also your responsibility. We need to warn people. We need to warn people. Flee the judgment that is about to come. God is a just God. God is a merciful God. But he's also a God who's just, and his justice demands judgment. And judgment will fall on unbelieving, sinful, wicked people. That is the word of God. God is not mocked. Whatsoever a man sows, that shall he reap. And it is our responsibility to tell people. You look at the person of Samson. Samson is one of the most tragic stories in all of the Bible. He had the most promising future. He had an anointing from birth. He had parents who dedicated him from birth, consecrated him to be a Nazarite, a special vow to God. And the Bible says the Spirit of God moved upon him at a young age in the camp. And he was anointed. But you know what? He began to compromise. He began to sin little by little. Little compromise here, he didn't get burnt. A little compromise there, it didn't affect him. A little sin here, he didn't feel the full consequences of it. But sooner or later, the sin bound him, and he ended up dying a tragic death. Sin has consequences, brothers and sisters. Sin will cause you to pay more than you want to pay, go further than you want to go, and keep you longer than you want to stay. And you see, we have a man who wholly followed the Lord. We have 10 spies who were leaders of the people, who were prominent in the community of Israel, in the nation of Israel, but they were people who did not wholly follow God, and thus their faith was weak. Caleb gave himself fully and unreservedly to God. You see, God has to be the center of your life. Can you put up that diagram? God has to be the center. Aisha sang last week, Jesus be the center of it all. And you see, God, Jesus has to be the center of our life. Every area of our life. You see, a lot of times we compartmentalize things. We say, Lord, you could be Lord of this area. You could be involved in this area. But you know what? I'm going to keep this close to me. I'm going to control this. But Jesus needs to be the center. God needs to be the center. And God needs to inform everything you do. Ministry, your life, yourself, your family, your relationships. Nothing. Well, I'm going to just hide. I got some relationships that I don't necessarily want God to know about. As if you could hide it from God. It's funny how we, you know, it's sometimes, you know, I know this because I'm human, and I've been in services when God's speaking and he's putting his finger on something. He's trying to bring conviction. It could be something to do with your finances, relationships, and you're almost like, I can't wait till the preacher gets done with this because I'm ducking and jiving. Oh, come on. Is anybody going to be honest? Do I have to read your mail this morning? But the reality of it is God already sees everything. And in our whole life, God needs to inform our work. You know, we spend 40, 50, 60 hours at work. Don't you think God is concerned about that? Don't you think we need to pray about our workplace? Trust in the Lord with all of your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, In all your ways, your family, your finances. Your finances, acknowledge him. In what? In that word acknowledge in the original Hebrew means know him. An intimate knowledge so that you know God in your workplace, in your finances, in your relationships. You know, how many times I hear people, don't I don't want to tell anybody about that. You know, yes, it's okay to be private. God, not everybody needs to know your business, but we can't be hiding things either. We've got to walk in the light. We've got to walk in the light. And what happens when people begin to sin? They begin to pull back from the church. Pull back from fellowship. Stop calling you. Stop fellowshipping. Why? Because the Bible says if men's deeds are sinful, they hate the light. They don't want to come to the light. They avoid it at all costs. You know, if you have some godly, holy people in your life, you know, I guarantee if you start doing the wrong thing, you're not going to want to go visit them. You're not going to call them anymore. You're going to start to avoid them. But if our deeds are of truth, the Bible says we come to the light so the light might make it manifest. How many of you are still with me this morning? See, Caleb wholly followed the Lord. Jesus needs to be the hub. God needs to be the hub, the center. You know, we also use the metaphor or the illustration of priorities in life, right? You know, seek first the kingdom. God needs to be at the top. And that's true, and that's biblical. But I think sometimes, I think it's better to look at it this way. The reason being, you could have priorities, God number one, but your other priorities could be, well, oh, I got God first, so now I can do these other things the way I want. No. Everything has to relate back to God. Jesus be the center. Oh, come on. When it comes to your finances, do you know that Jesus needs to be the center, not only of the tithe, but of what you do with the rest of your money? Hello, is God speaking to anyone this morning? Come on, God's not just, you know, don't, oh God, that's good for that person next to me. Oh, I'm glad he brought that up because I was thinking that about her. No. It's about you this morning. God is trying to speak to you and about the tithe and about offerings and about being generous with what God has blessed you with. Hello? We talked about relationship, our workplace. You know, our workplace is a mission field. We're to be a light to a dark world. And workplaces can be so difficult. You know, it could be so difficult when you're ostracized and talked about. But when you look at what Jesus said, rejoice when men speak evil of you for my name's sake. Rejoice when they ridicule you, when they persecute you for my name's sake. Rejoice, for great is your reward in heaven. Glad you seem so excited about that. Jesus. And see, for Caleb, the Lord was the center. He wholly followed the Lord. There were no closed doors to God. No doors or no parts of the life that are off limits to God. You see, the Holy Spirit wants to speak to us and wants to inform every area of our life that God is really concerned about every area of our life. Let me share this with you. I haven't shared this in a long time. But, you know, when I was dating Pastor Lisa, or engaged actually, you know, for me, I was in love with her and I wanted to get married. I was 27, 28 years old, and in the Assemblies of God back then in our district, Rhode Island, Connecticut, and Massachusetts, there were 142 churches, and there were only two single pastors, and I was one of them. And, you know, it's good to be a pastor to be married. It's not prerequisite, but I wanted to get married and love my wife. We were engaged, about to be married, and I still wanted to make sure, God, I love my wife, but I love you more. Hello? You say, is that right? You're going to get in trouble, Pastor, with your wife later? No, it's biblical. The Lord has to be the center. The Lord has to be number one. And I want a woman who loves God more than me. Because if she loves God more than me, she's going to love me. Hello? But you know what I did? With all the most, see what's tough. Let me just talk to you about if you're in relationships and you want to get married and you're involved in a relationship, it's so difficult to discern God's voice because your emotions get so cloud out your the voice of God. And it's so difficult, but I was praying, God, I want your will. Now, you're hearing what I'm saying this morning. Now, this is real. This ain't a story. This ain't, you know, some book, some illustration I found in a book. This was real life, real time. And you know what I did? I went on a 3-day fast. And I said to God, God, if I'm missing it, if she's not the one. How many of you know in Bible school this, I don't know if you've ever been through this or heard about this in church, you know, there are a lot of people running around and thinking, you're God's will for my life. You know, oh, I pray, God, show me you're the one. Well, I'm not trying to puff myself up, but, you know, I had a few Bible school students who thought I was the will. Somebody, all of them were wrong. But God, what is your will? So I prayed and I fasted and I said, God, I want your will. And I went on a 3-day fast, and this was leading right up to the wedding. But I said, God, even if I have to look like a fool, God, if I'm missing it, I want to. See, here's what it was. I wanted to know that I know that I know that it's God's will. Why? Because it's that important. It's that important. It has everything to do with the trajectory of your life, the decisions of your life. You know that saying in the movie Gladiator, what you do in this life will echo in eternity. And that was a profound statement in that movie. What you do in this life will echo in eternity. And that's a truth. And that wasn't said from the Bible. That wasn't said from a Bible character or a Bible movie. But how many of you know all truth is God's truth? And that was a truth. What we do in this life will echo in eternity. So we want to know that we're holy, holy, holy following the Lord. And I just conclude with this. Just 3 quick points. These are not the main points. These are sub-points under a point. Did you get the point? Caleb had a different spirit. And we see this early in his life. As a leader up until that point in Numbers 13, he's 40 years old. And you know what? We don't hear about what his life was like up until 40. But what we do know, he was wholly following the Lord. So that means in his private life, he was wholly following God. It's one thing to live a godly life or to appear godly and holy when you're in front of people. Hello? But it's another thing to be godly and holy when no one's watching you, because that is your character. See, that's who your character, the real you is who you are in darkness. The real you is who you are when nobody's watching. When the pastor's not watching, when your spouse is not watching, when no one's watching, what you are in private. And see, it's easy. It's easier to serve God in public, because there's a certain amount of glory that comes with it, or appreciation, or good feeling if you sing or if you preach or you minister and serve in front of people. But it's another thing to do those things faithfully when no one's watching. And faithfulness is not for a week or a month, but for a lifetime. God calls us to live a life. And what is the promise, or what is the commendation we want to hear from the Lord? Well done, thou good and faithful servant. That's a lifetime. How many people have started out in this journey and are not here anymore? I'm not talking about coming to victory, but I'm talking about they're not going to any church. They're not walking with God anymore. And they were good people, and they were serving, and they were believing, but somewhere along the line, they stopped wholly, wholly following the Lord. And this is a serious thing. It's not just a thing we can wink at, or well, maybe it'll all work out. No, it's important that in your private life, that's your character, that you walk with God in his early life, but also in his when he came from spying out the land. This is his public life. The Bible says he wholly followed the Lord. He had a different spirit. How do we know he had a different spirit? Because he saw differently. Others saw obstacles. He saw God. Others saw the difficulty. Brothers and sisters, life will always be difficult. Life will always have its challenges. But if your faith is vibrant, if your faith is alive, if you're hearing the word, if you're believing the word, if you're receiving it this morning, If you're responding to it, you know what? When the obstacles come, your faith will inform your situation. You see, he saw differently. He measured the giants by his God. We see when they came to Jericho, what did God say? See, I have given you the city. They had to see differently. They had to see by faith. I want to ask you, how's your eyesight this morning? I'm not talking about your physical eyesight. The older I get, I either need longer arms or stronger glasses. My natural sight is dimming a little bit. But God is concerned about our spiritual sight. Do you see differently? You know, some people have vision. You know, I remember years ago in a previous house when we renovated our family room. And we gutted it out. And my mother and father were still alive. And of course, because I want to tell them that they said something, they had to be alive. But my father came and I tried to explain to him what we were going to do in that room. We're going to put a fireplace there. We're going to, you know, window there. And I remember my father, God rest his soul. He was just like, he shook his head. He said, I can't see it. He just couldn't. He didn't have the vision for a renovation. Some people have the vision. They can walk into a room and redecorate it. Just, you know, in this building, when we renovated this building, we had someone in the church who paid for an interior decorator. I don't know how many thousands of dollars. We wouldn't have probably done that, but they came in, and that's what they live and move and breathe in, and they just said, yes, 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 no, no, no. What would have taken us months to try to discern what looks good with what color? Vision. They could see differently. You and I, as the people of God, should be noted for that, that we see things differently. We walk in a situation, and we don't see all the problems. You ever see some people, all they see is problems. They just got a negative bent. They meet someone, and instead of shaking hands, they shake their heads. Instead of smiling, they sigh. But see differently. God wants us to, if we have a different spirit, we'll be able to see differently. And then he spoke differently. You see the 10 spies, there is no mention of God in their report. No mention of God. But you hear Caleb saying, the Lord's kept me alive. The Lord will be with us. The Lord will drive out the enemy. I want you to get that in your vocabulary. When you wake up in the morning, the Lord's kept me alive. When you're not feeling physically that great, the Lord's given me strength. And you begin to prophesy it, and you begin to declare it over your life. How many of you know, I know you know this, the power of the tongue. The power of your words, to speak them forth, to have a paradigm shift. And maybe you've been brought up with a negativity and a downcast spirit, and you just tend to see always the dark side and the negative side. And maybe you were brought up like that, and I understand that. But you know what? The Bible talks about our mind being renewed, our spirit being renewed, and our tongue needs to be renewed. If you look at things and you're always seeing the negative, you got to pray, God, help me to look at things differently and help me to speak differently. If you're brought up negative, always complaining, always speaking negative, it's easy to fall into that rut. And then when you go through a trial, you're just negative, negative, negative. But stop. And I believe Caleb had a different spirit in his life. He was always seeing God involved. Hello? He was seeing God involved. And you know, even in creation, the Bible says in the Psalms that all of creation declares the glory of God. Even in the sunset, even in the beauty of a sun, even in the beauty of the foliage turning, the leaves turning red, there's the beauty and the glory of God being declared every day. And even nature can be a sacrament, if you will. Could be a means of grace and a means of blessing as we see the glory and the goodness of God. Come on, somebody say amen. So you're going to start speaking differently. You're going to start mentioning God. And then finally in his latter days, and I close with this, he had a different spirit. He wholeheartedly followed the Lord. He says in Joshua chapter 14, verse 9, he said, the Lord spoke in that day through Moses. You see, for Caleb, he had a promise from God that literally kept him going. You see, the promise helped them to persevere. The promise helped them to believe. The promise helped them to keep on keeping on. I want to ask you, do you have a promise from God this morning? You say, well, I need a promise. I need a dream. I need a vision. Well, God will give you one, but you know what? He's given you his word, and there are about 7,000 promises in the book. Yeah, you can find one for your need this morning. You can find a promise that'll make a difference. He said, the Lord kept me alive in his latter day, and he said, the Lord gave me strength. The Lord gave me strength. Would you stand together with me this morning? God wants you to have a different spirit this morning. He wants you to see differently. He wants you to speak differently. And he wants you to believe differently than others. This morning, I don't know what you're facing, but I believe that faith will turn the night into day. Faith will make a difference in your life to help you to persevere, to keep on keeping on. To be able to say like Caleb, I am strong this day. Hallelujah. I was with a pastor yesterday and he was telling me about preaching, and he was preaching a message on finishing strong, and this goes right along with what Caleb, how Caleb lived his life. And he said he was preaching that, and someone came up to him after the service and said, you know, I used to serve, I used to be so involved, and you know, I'm a little older now, and I guess the guy was might have been close to 60, and he was basically saying, you know, it's time for me to step back and just let others do the work. And it's true, we need to raise up another generation, but we need the older folks to still be serving God, amen? We don't stop in this journey, you know? Caleb said, I'm strong this day as I was 45 years ago. I'm 85 years, and I still want to take a giant. I want to take a mountain for God. I want the Holy Spirit to inspire you to believe for a lost loved one to be saved. I want to inspire you to believe for a revival, a breakthrough, for God to bring fruitfulness in a harvest where there's been barrenness in your life, for God to remove some long-standing mountains in your life. God is still able. It takes faith. It takes a different spirit. It takes someone who wholly, wholly follows the Lord. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for your word. God, I pray your blessing. God, your blessing's already on your word, but I pray your blessing upon the hearts of your people to receive the life-giving power of the word of God. Holy Spirit, help us to have a different spirit. Help us to wholly, wholly follow the Lord. God, today in this place, God, may we begin to see things turn around, whether it's in a statistic of Providence being the least biblically literate city in America. God, let us do our part to learn the word of God. Whether it's in our church and we need to see more people serving and producing fruit in ministry, God, give us that mountain, Lord. God, it's a mountain. There are giants in the way, but God, you are well able to give us that mountain. You are well able. We can't do it, but the Lord giving us strength is able to do it. Father, thank you for your word. Bless your people. May the power of your word come alive in our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. God bless you this morning. May the word of God go with you.